All right, guys, let me quickly show you the disclaimer. So this webinar is being recorded and transferred to the internet. So please make sure that you quickly read through the disclaimer. Give you a couple of seconds here. And as always, here is the contact form as well as the phone number, the opening hours, and all the details needed in case you have any questions regarding this webinar, future webinars, and so on. Maybe quickly about my persona. Some people may have heard some webinars from me in the past. So I've been looking at the financial markets for quite a while now, and I'm actually coming out of the technology business. So that's why cryptocurrencies are quite interesting for me. And over at Blue Alpine Research, I'm doing regularly videos and podcasts about investment opportunities, technology changes, as well as ratings for cryptocurrencies. I would say let's continue and look. Let's have a look at today's agenda. Essentially, we're talking about airdrops, but what are airdrops? Why is this relevant for you as an investor, as a trader? How does it work from a technical standpoint? Why are we focused on XRP? What is Spark, the airdrop we're talking about today? And what kind of requirements are needed? Is there anything needed from your side that you need to do actively or not actively, as well as any strategies that you can have for the future, for future airdrops in any kind of capacity, and as well as a short reminder about security, as these are cryptocurrencies and it is sometimes forgotten. So that's why I want to quickly mention it, as well as in combination with airdrops. And at the end, of course, summary as well as questions if you have some. So the first big questions: what are airdrops? Essentially, airdrops are a way to distribute a new token or a coin to a broader audience. So you're kind of leveraging an existing audience or the existing coin's infrastructure to get new users and followers. That means you're not starting from zero, having a marketing department and infrastructure and the technical aspects and so on, but you can actually gain and start with the infrastructure that's already existing. One example of an airdrop is from 2017, is a coin that some of you may know. It's called OmiseGo, or was previously called like this. Nowadays, it's called OMG Network, and it was based on Ethereum. So the goal was that you could use the infrastructure of Ethereum, and during this ICO hype, OmiseGo has started with having this airdrop with just 5% of the entire stack of coins should be set aside to be given to Ethereum users. There was certain requirement needed, which we will look at with Spark as well. In this case, there was a 0.1 Ethereum threshold needed in order to be considered. And the OMG price today is around $360. That was yesterday, the highest during the bull run. End of 2017 was around $24, and it has been, of course, volatile since then. But what is interesting here is if we look at the chart, that the airdrop happened pretty much at the mid of 2017, and then we of course had this crazy run with the highest point. And you can see that an airdrop can actually be quite profitable if invested, if taken at the right time. Of course, if you cannot trade it at the right time, or if you don't trade it, or if you decide to hold it for longer, you might have to have a bit of a longer breath here in this case to actually get to break even or to sell at break even. Some call airdrops actually irregular dividends. I don't completely agree, but some people in the industry call it like this because it's essentially a way to be to have a reward for keeping or holding the respective coin. Others do call it free money. I mean, let's call it how it is. It is technically also free money. One example of this is the Uniswap or Uni distributed to all past users of the decentralized exchange Uniswap. So all the people who have been using the exchange in the past have received these 400 UNI tokens. That was just a couple of weeks or months ago. And UNI then quickly jumped to $8 to $9, making essentially giving every holder of these 400 UNI essentially around $3,500 for free. Again, here the chart, and you can see it's very crazy. As soon as an airdrop happens, usually, or if a token is being listed on an exchange, you can see these crazy volatility spikes. And I mean, this is still cryptocurrency, guys. You shouldn't forget that this is still the Wild West of cryptocurrency time. So these there are a lot of chances to make a lot of gains here, but you have to know what you're getting into, especially when it comes to airdrops. Now, let's have a look at what airdrops are actually not. Airdrops are not really classical forks. So one of the most known fork that we know today is the Bitcoin Cash fork that happened in August 2017. Now, usually forks, be it soft fork or hard fork, happen more on a technical level. So the chain splits into two different directions, because in let's say Bitcoin Cash's case, it was because the block size was a bit different. There was an ideological discussion around it as well. So they hard forked away from the Bitcoin chain and created Bitcoin Cash. While at the same time, they created this kind of snapshot to give every Bitcoin Cash user the same amount of Bitcoin Cash as they had on the Bitcoin chain. Again, this is not exactly what's happening in Spark's case, but we'll look at this in more detail. What are airdrops also not? They are not staking rewards. So some of you may have heard of staking rewards. And one very simple example is you leave one, this could be Ethereum, with us, and we will pay you two XYZ. This can be any example every quarter. So you essentially provide liquidity and we pay you for it. So this is kind of an option that staking rewards can give you. Staking can also work a bit differently, such as in Ethereum's proof of stake case, where you get rewarded an annual reward for staking the coins. But again, this is not staking rewards. So airdrops in this discussion is not the same. In this case, we use these Ethereum to make returns. Partial returns are transferred to you. And I would say this is more how centralized finance or decentralized finance products these days work. Of course, this is more of a higher term, but most, let's say, decentralized credits and so on work in this kind of capacity. Airdrops are also not scams. So a lot of people do or tend to say that airdrops can actually be scams. And I tend to disagree, to be honest, because scams, yes, they do happen and we have to be careful. And that's why I also want to quickly mention that not all airdrops are scams, but once they happen and they do happen, we will quickly look at them in the security chapter. In the past, there have been scam airdrops, or rather scammers who have used the hype around a token or around an airdrop to actually create a scam airdrop. Something similar can technically happen with Spark. So that's why you have to be really careful where you deposit your coins and with what exchange, etc. But we'll dive a bit deeper in the security chapter into this topic. Technically they are not correct airdrops anyway. If it's a scam, then they have this goal to kind of steal money or coins from you, so it's not really an airdrop. What is really important here is that usually airdrops happen mostly on the Ethereum network. So most airdrops still happen in this Ethereum Ethereum ecosystem with this token standard, which is called ERC20. So over 77% are still ERC20 tokens, so Ethereum ecosystem. And we will see right away in the coming chapter why this is relevant in our case, because the main question people have been asking is why XRP? Why not just launch it via Ethereum as an ERC20 token This is kind of the big question that we want to have a look at. In order to understand XRP, and you will have to excuse, I will probably make this mistake in this presentation as well. We're talking about XRP, the coin, not Ripple, the company. Now, a lot of people do mix these up, and it's actually not their fault, because people have been calling XRP Ripple or Ripple coin for quite a while. But if we look at it from the company token aspect, it is Ripple, the company, XRP, the token. Although, like I said, some people do call it Ripple coin, Ripple token, whatever. Please, as I said, excuse me if I use it as Ripple, but I try to really make that distinction clear as to avoid any confusion. Now, XRP, the token, or Ripple, the company, has built products that do use XRP. That doesn't mean that all of their products do use XRP. So Ripple is in the business of transferring value or transferring liquidity, if you will. And Ripple, the company, has also some of the best partnerships in the space. You will see many known banks such as BBVA, Santander, UBS, UniCredit, and so on. All these kind of bigger companies and banks that have these partnerships with Ripple. That, like I said, that doesn't mean that Ripple or these partnerships or all these companies are using XRP, the coin. It just means that the Ripple, the company, has these partnerships where they sell specific products that sometimes do use XRP. Interestingly, one very important factor, especially in bull run times, and you will excuse the screenshot, it is of course before the correction that just happened about 12 hours ago, the XRP is the cheapest coin in the top five by market capitalization. Now, known traders or experienced traders and investors will know that this doesn't have anything to do with kind of what the potential of a token or a coin or a stock, to be honest, is. However, psychologically, as the crypto space is still ruled a lot by retail traders see this Bitcoin price and get immediately scared by the price increase that it experienced in the last couple of weeks. And people do not know actually that you can buy half a Bitcoin or partial Bitcoin, same with Ethereum, same with Litecoin. So they look for the cheapest coin. So Bitcoin is too expensive. What else can I buy? But this is not the actual reason. XRP is scaling quite well. And this is actually a screenshot, I think from 2017, where compared to other cryptocurrencies, we can see that XRP can, at its peak, get to around 50,000 transactions per second. Again, this is from 2017. Assuming that the development hasn't stopped, chances are that the highest point is technically even higher than Visa. Usually, when you compare cryptocurrency transactions per second, you always look at companies like Visa and MasterCard in order to say, okay, this is actually ready for daily use. However, consistently, XRP is handling more than 1,000 transactions per second, which is still a lot more than Bitcoin's 8 to 10 or 7 to 8, as displayed here, transactions per second. As for reference, Ethereum, I think, is between 15 to 18 transactions per second. That's why there has been a lot of development in the Ethereum space for Ethereum 2.0 to also increase the transaction per second numbers. However, we're talking today about XRP and kind of trying to understand why XRP has been selected, let's say, for this Spark airdrop. Now, we see XRP is being used by Ripple customers as well as crypto users. I know a lot of people who use XRP as the token to transfer money around, because sometimes Ethereum gets stuck and Bitcoin can also get either stuck or expensive, so they are using XRP. However, what XRP is lacking is smart contract functionality. Now, smart contract functionality is something that Ethereum made quite popular by 2017, and it's also kind of what spiked this grand, let's say, ICO hype. A smart contract is essentially an algorithm or a contract that has been programmed to work with an underlying asset, and exchange that with either token or ether. So you as an investor, you as a programmer, you as an asset owner can create smart contracts to be fulfilled in certain circumstances. So let's say whenever the 20th of the month arrives, please pay my electricity bill automatically. So deduct this directly from my bank account now, or in this case, from my Ether wallet. Now, of course, this is a very simple example, but we have seen in the industry that smart contracts are quite a powerful tool that a lot of cryptocurrencies are still lacking, especially also Bitcoin. There is also this discussion around how or is it possible to integrate smart contract functionality into Bitcoin. The same can be said for XRP, which is still in the top five and also doesn't have this smart contract functionality. Additionally, XSpring or CrossSpring, the investment arm of Ripple Labs, is invested in Flare. And Flare, this is the first time I'm mentioning this, Flare or Flare Networks are actually the creator of this airdrop, of this Spark token. So there is a very tight partnership and investment relationship between Ripple, the company, or XSpring, their investment arm, and Flare Networks. So there was also maybe a certain incentive or maybe documentation or maybe some guidance in terms of helping them to actually bring this airdrop to XRP. Flare Networks wants to bridge this gap between XRP and the rest of the blockchain. And of course, if you haven't, if you have followed cryptocurrencies in the last, let's say, 6 to 9 months, you probably heard of DeFi, decentralized finance. The idea is, again, to have no middleman in these decentralized finance products and have kind of a gateway to interact with the financial markets. Now, 99.9% are mainly controlled by Ethereum-based applications, meaning that in order to enter this DeFi world and to actually interact with this DeFi world, you need Ethereum or Ethereum-based applications. XRP, the token, the coin itself, is lacking these features like smart contract functionality and Turing completeness, but has a very strong user base. Turing completeness is essentially a programming language that you can, or a language that you can use to explain any kind of programming concept. And not all cryptocurrencies do have Turing completeness, and XRP in this case is also lacking Turing completeness, whereas, for example, Ethereum does have this Turing completeness, making it quite attractive also for developers looking to build applications on this platform. Now, Flare wants to use this user base for additional growth. And that brings us actually to the let's say, the main topic or the main guest of this webinar, which is essentially Spark. Now, let's understand what is Spark in order to understand why XRP or Spark is being built on the back of XRP. So let's understand Flare first. Again, Flare Networks, the company behind the Spark token, they want to bridge this gap between XRP and the rest of the blockchain world. Now, this screenshot, I have taken this, I think yesterday or the day before, is essentially the amount of value locked in US dollars in the DeFi world. This is taken from a website called DeFi Pulse or DeFiPulse.com. You can check it out. And this is 14 billion US dollars. This has had a very strong growth since the summer. So essentially, you can see it on the chart that since July, this thing has been going up and up. And although there have been hacks and corrections and price corrections, nothing really fazed it too much, so that it's still growing quite strongly and will grow even more. And again, in order to get into this DeFi world, you need Ethereum-based ERC-20 tokens. You cannot participate in this kind of economy, in this DeFi economy, with XRP. And that actually brings us to Spark, because the idea that Flare Networks had with Spark was that 75% of the value that are in public blockchains cannot be used in a trustless manner with smart contracts. we of course have stuff like proof of work and proof of stake, and they have pros and cons, but the main con of proof of stake in the case of Ethereum 2.0 is that the incentive will be gone if another network gives you higher rewards. So that essentially means there will be competition between Cardano, Ethereum, EOS, and so on. So that kind of brings us also to this, how Flare Networks is trying to disengage the value aspect from the coin aspect. And I've taken this from the Flare blog directly, and it is quite a lot of unpack here. But essentially, what type of issue is Flare trying to solve? And it's essentially at its core a new way of scaling smart contract platforms that does not link safety with the value of its token. Now, we will look at these separately. Flare still requires a token for the operation of the network, principally to deter spam transactions. Flare's token is called Spark. Because Spark doesn't have network safety implications, and that essentially means that it is not used for proof of work or proof of stake, it is well suited to enable the trustless usage of non-Turing complete tokens with smart contracts. But let's go through it separately. Scaling smart contract platforms. Again, by using XRP, it is much, much easier to scale this thing. So by using the infrastructure of XRP, there is the basis to scale this thing much easier. And I think this is somewhat the most important part of the sentence. It does not link safety with the value of its token. Now, in Ethereum or in Ethereum 2.0's case, we have this thing called proof of stake. So proof of stake incentive is set at 15% per year. So that means if you lock your Ethereum tokens for 1 year in the Ethereum 2.0 contract, that means that you will receive a 15% reward by the end of the year. Now, if the Ethereum price changes in any kind of way, these incentives will have to change in order to attract more people. And that brings me back to this comparison I made earlier. So Cardano, EOS, Ethereum are in direct competition when it comes to these incentives, because ideally the proof of stake network or the proof of stake consensus mechanism will only work if people actually deposit their Ethereum into the contract. Flare Network doesn't want that, so they introduce a new token, and this token is called Spark. Now, deterring spam transactions, if you had a network that would be feeless, you would have a misuse of spammers, and you can see this in different types of networks and different types of blockchain technology networks. Wherever you see very little activity, it is most oftentimes used for kind of bad behavior. So in this case, again, if the network wouldn't have any fees, it would be used by spammers. Spark doesn't have network safety implications, so Spark is actually not used for creating consensus or securing the chain. So creating consensus is another explanation for securing the chain. So again, using proof of work or proof of stake means essentially that you have a specific safety element in the blockchain. Spark is not directly used for this, so that means it is kind of detracted from these safety implications. Non-Turing complete tokens, again, tokens that, for example, are not Ethereum-based, are not necessarily Turing complete. So that means they are quite difficult to interact with. And that means that, again, this type of value will be locked away unless you have any kind of token that would be able to connect to this. So too long, didn't read. Spark is a token that is being used on the new Flare network that brings technological advances such as smart contracts using XRP as its base. That, however, is not everything. So later on, and this is still up for discussion, so it's not really relevant for this discussion, but I think it's important that I mention it for completeness sake. It later might be used for exchanging to Flare XRP. This will be kind of an in-between token that you can use. So you can probably change Spark to FXRP 1-to-1. It can or might be used to interact with other cryptocurrencies, and it can or might be used to govern the Flare network. Again, because we're super early in this stage, and because, yeah, in my opinion, Swissquote reacted correctly by, first of all, making sure that the snapshot is being supported by Swissquote, this is for now, for us as investors or traders, the most important part. This is a more, let's say, technical perspective on these things, but I think it's quite important to understand that in the future, this Spark token might actually have a different type of value. What are the details of this airdrop? I think this is quite important because in order to evaluate airdrops in the future, you might have to understand kind of what the details are. Right now, 100 billion Spark tokens will be created. This is parallel to XRP. And out of those 100 billion, 45 billion Spark tokens will be claimable by XRP holders. Meaning, if you have XRP, and if you're holding XRP, and in this case, if you're holding XRP on the Swissquote exchange, you will be able to claim these Spark tokens. Of course, not all 45 billion, but of course, in relation to your XRP holdings. 25 billion Spark tokens are going to the Flare Networks Limited. This is actually a for-profit company. However, we also have 30 billion Spark tokens that will go to the Flare Foundation. What happens if a token is not claimed? So let's say you have XRP, you wait for 6 months, you are not part of the snapshot, these tokens will be burnt. This is burnt in essentially means that in this case, they will be destroyed. So these tokens will not be tradable after 6 months. It is important to mention that there was also a stable coin planned, but for now, there is not a lot of information on this, and it's important to note that Spark is not that stablecoin. So it's very possible that there will be a separate coin that will be a stablecoin in this case, but like I said, it will be completely separate from Spark. So Spark is not a stablecoin. You don't have to worry about this at all. Airdrop requirements. What do you need to do in actual steps to be able to participate here? Generally, always check the website of the network that is doing the airdrop on the details. So you have to look for exchanges, wallets that are supporting this. So let's say you don't have your XRP holdings on the Swissquote exchange, you hold it in your local wallet. That means your wallet has to support this airdrop in order for you to participate. It also can make the process a bit more difficult, to be honest, because normally as a wallet holder or as a holder of these tokens in the wallet, you might have to do some additional steps. You have to check the details on the numbers. Is it actually worth it? Here we have a classic example, OMG or OmiseGo versus Spark. In Spark's case, we have a 1-to-1. So one XRP will equal one Spark token. In OmiseGo's case or in OMG's case, we've had these 5% of the total amount. So it wasn't really 1-to-1. Correctly. Again, you can look this up, and this was taken directly from the Flare Network's website where you can see the supporting exchanges. They do update this regularly, so you have to keep an eye on that as well as the supporting wallets in order to see whether your wallet is actually being supported. In some cases, you actually don't have to do anything, which is, in my opinion, the best case. Your favorite wallet supports this, excellent, so you don't have to do anything, or your favorite exchange is supporting it, which means that usually you don't have to do anything. There are cases where you have to prepare your wallet or your coins in order to participate. Again, if you don't hold it on the exchange, usually it means that you need to do additional work. Important to note here, Swissquote supports this airdrop. That means you won't have to do anything. What you will have to do, and we're coming to this step, is, or let's explain quickly the process. Usually a so-called snapshot of the blockchain happens at a specific time. So essentially you can have a quick overview or an overview of all the token holders at a very specific time. in order to participate. If you miss this snapshot, there is no chance to claim them. Usually, let's go for the normal case here. After the claiming, after that, the claiming process starts. And again, if you hold your tokens or your XRP coins on an exchange, you usually don't have to do something actively here. So the claiming process is just everyone who holds X by Y will get Z. So that means that if you hold, I don't know, 10 XRP by the 12th of December, because that is the snapshot date, you will get 12 Spark tokens automatically added to your portfolio. In this case, again, everyone who has XRP on the Swissquote exchange by the 12th December, and this is important because the timing does play a role, 00 GMT will be included in this snapshot. The split will be one XRP to one Spark token, and you don't have to do anything actively for the snapshot except have your coins on Swissquote. And this is quite important because people tend to forget to transfer the coins either to Swissquote or to buy them because they wanted to buy them or they had a buy order in there. They need to be there by the 12th December, 00 GMT, in order to actually be claimable by you. They will usually appear automatically in your portfolio. So in specific cases or depending on the exchange, they usually just automatically appear. Sometimes you have to do an update on the wallet, for example. But I would say in Swissquote's kind of situation, it will be that they will appear automatically. Currently, and Swissquote is checking the logistics of this, they will be tradable in 2021. So they will be, you will get them if you are part of the snapshot, but you won't be able, currently at least, you won't be able to trade them immediately, and you will be able to trade them in 2021. Again, super important, make sure your coins are on Swissquote before that. Sometimes transfer times can vary, you can make a mistake with the address and so on. So if you wanted to buy the coins or if you wanted to transfer them to Swissquote, make sure that you're doing this before the 12th of December in order to be included. I already see there are some questions. I will get to those in a second. Just give me one more couple of slides and then we'll be through. Strategies for airdrops. So what kind of strategies as a trader or as an investor will you or should you have? Generally, or general rule of thumb here is the bigger the project, the more likely the effect on the airdrop. So participate only in the big ones. Spark is definitely a big one. You have to get ready for a period of slow growth if you don't sell right away at the beginning. Again, this varies on your strategy, this varies on the token, this varies on the exchange. There are so many variables, but just be ready for some slow growth if you don't sell right away. Within a couple of weeks or months, the price usually recovers. We have seen this with the OMG chart. We have seen this with the Uni token chart as well. So within a couple of months, you were back to either break even or even in profit. So plan accordingly. From a trading perspective, I would say you should take them as they come. So they are, in some cases, they are interesting to help your portfolio. You can keep them if you believe in the vision, the product, the team. So I believe, let's look at it from an investor's perspective. Flare Networks wants to enable or activate the 75% of value that is currently not reachable in public blockchains. Looking at the DeFi market and looking at the growth of the DeFi market, chances are this market will keep on growing. So that means that with Spark tokens, you will probably have the option of participating in these markets in some kind of way. That means that taking and keeping them is actually a good idea here. You can also take them and sell them at the right time, of course. You can, depending on your portfolio strategy, you can sell them right away, make a profit, or wait and then make a profit, sell them at break even, don't sell them at all, treat it as free money, however you prefer. Or to be honest, you don't have to participate at all. If the project is not interesting, if the hassle is too much, so let's say you have to actively do many steps in order to get to these tokens, which in Sparks and Swissquote's aspect is not really an issue, then it might be too much hassle. You can check airdrop calendars to see whether other airdrops are happening. Here we have airdropbob.com and airdrops.io, but do make sure that it's actually an airdrop and not just a sign-up bonus or a referral link. This, for example, is a sign-up bonus or a referral link. Let's check the airdrop rules. How many tokens will be distributed? Where do you need to have your coins? What wallets or exchanges are supporting the airdrop? Again, sometimes a lot of work is needed and not always worth the hassle in your case. Airdrop tools, in my opinion, are these calendars that you can have a look at. The wallets, of course, MyEther wallet or MetaMask are usually also good choices. If you prefer to keep the wallets privately or with yourself, then you can manage them through there. But again, just check them whether it's supported. And then what is really helpful is, of course, strategy on what you will do when, as well as patience. We can see here, it can be quite profitable, and if not, if you don't sell at the top, you have to have a lot of patience. So the recovery time can be quite a long time, and this is timing period-wise. This is about three and a half years now. So from the creation of Bitcoin Cash, it has been more or less, in the last couple of years, especially flat since the big correction. So patience is needed. Trading airdrops is usually like trading coins or stocks. You should define exit prices. You try to find the value, which sometimes is very difficult, but you can check the team, the product, the vision, and so on. Liquidity can be a problem. I don't think in Sparks token it will be an issue, but do plan accordingly, especially if you are getting airdrops from, let's say, dubious exchanges, then liquidity can be an issue. So depending on the hype, not all airdrop tokens are tradable right away. What if you miss the airdrop? It can still be worthwhile to buy and trade them afterwards. Uni got dropped to all users. I think in September, it shot up to $3.5 right away. An entry at $350, which seemed very expensive to some, would have been possible with an exit at 720. I was able to catch that trade, which was okay. And then you can observe also the hype around the project. And like I said, Spark has a lot of hype. So the chances of a price rise are definitely here. So it can be quite interesting. But as always, don't FOMO, fear of missing out. There's always the next coin trade, airdrop, etc. Let's quickly strive on the topic of security, because I think it's quite an overlooked but important topic. Cryptocurrencies are fairly new and potential risks are not always clear. So there is a lot of hype around airdrops and that can be quite dangerous. There are different types of scams you have to keep a lookout, and information phishing, private key phishing, bait and switch, referral scam. In my opinion, the private key phishing is the most important, but the information phishing is essentially trying to steal emails or addresses or wallet information in order to get to the private key phishing, which is in my opinion one of the most severe types of security breaches that can happen. So sometimes landing pages or phishing pages, they will tell you it's a requirement to participate in the airdrop, a verification step to participate in the airdrop, a needed step to get more coin. And that usually they ask then for your private key. One example of this in 2017 was actually Omise Go. So there was an airdrop, it got delayed, and 300 Ethereum or even a bit more, I think, got stolen afterwards. Private key, so you can lose all your coins like this. Double check the exchange, the site. Never ever are private keys needed for an airdrop, and usually just go with the secure exchanges like Swissquote in order to avoid this. The bait and switch is something that I've showed you just earlier. Your information is used for referrals. It can be for privacy and identity misuse. I want to quickly go through the summary, then we can actually jump into the questions. Airdrops are meant to increase the user base. So it's meant to go on the back of an existing infrastructure. And if treated right, they can be like free money, but you need a strategy with them. Why XRP? It's scalable. but they don't have any DeFi possibilities, no smart contracts, etc. And Flare Networks, again, wants to bridge the gap between XRP and the rest of the blockchain world, in this case, namely the DeFi world. Flare will airdrop Spark token to all XRP holders. Snapshot time is then. Make sure that you transfer or buy the XRP tokens before that date. Actually, most airdrops are not worth the hassle, so only follow the biggest ones. Spark, in my opinion, is a big one. It's worth following, it's worth trading, it's worth holding, and check the details on the airdrops to see whether it's actually worthwhile. Trade them like normal coins, because technically they are, but again, only the big ones. Don't treat the small airdrops like proper coins, because most of them actually are not. And if you miss an airdrop, you can still trade the coin. And don't neglect security, meaning never give out your private keys from your wallet for an airdrop. And that's actually it. If you have any questions, I'm definitely around to answer the questions. I will try to open them up a bit more. I see there are already some questions. Let me see whether I can make that a bit bigger. So there is already, will Ripple, the company, get most of the Spark as they own half of the XRP? That's a very good question, but no, they won't. So Ripple, the company, as well as their employees, are actually excluded from this airdrop. What would be the price of these flares to be expected? It's Spark token, not flares, just not to mix it up. Nobody knows, to be honest. Me giving out price predictions would be wrong in this case. In my opinion, it can be very well in the area of XRP with a lot of volatility. Hello, if I buy XRP on the 12th of December at 23:55 p.m., will I be entitled in the snapshot? And there, hold on, the question. Cuts. Okay, thank you, Nikki. Nikki, so you are technically taken at the snapshot of 00. So buying them then usually wouldn't give you the part of the tokens. Do you believe personally in the Flare project? I think they have a lot of strong points. To be honest, I think also that the Flare project has the right motivation to start with this. The DeFi world is huge. We have seen it in the last couple of, I would say 6 months, 7 months. And I think introducing new coins or bridging this gap for new coins is actually quite interesting. So I think, or at least I think participating in the project or in the airdrop is definitely worth your while. Can we transfer XRP from different trading platforms, or should we sell externally and buy with Swissquote? Cosmin, you can essentially treat that. However, I would say buy them with Swissquote so you have them. If you have them with another trading platform or another exchange, you just have to make sure that it is actually supported for this airdrop. It can very well be that the exchange is not supporting it, which could cause you headache because you wouldn't get the airdrop. Mark is asking, will Swissquote offer functionality to hold any other tokens in the future or just specific tokens? I'm not speaking in the name of Swissquote here, Mark, but I would assume that also Swissquote is looking at this for newer or different tokens in the future.
So yeah, so I can just jump in there to answer that for Mark. So yeah, absolutely. As Spark or Flare token comes online, we will support that. It will be Q1 or Q2 next year. So bear in mind, you will not be able to trade it until it's properly functional on all exchanges. In terms of further tokens and further crypto assets, yes, we do have some more coming in Q1. So watch this space for what we will be bringing live. But if you do have any preferences, strong preferences, or you know, desires to see certain coins, certainly contact us through Twitter and suggest them, or contact us privately to suggest them, and we'll be open to listening what our customers really want to be trading through Swissquote.
Very cool.
Back over to Feyyaz.
How long should I keep XRP after December 12th to qualify for the airdrop? Jean-Marc, you actually only have to have them by this timing. So the snapshot, once the snapshot is taken, technically you can sell your XRP afterwards as well. But yeah, you can keep your XRP kind of depending on your strategy.
Feyyaz, what do you think will happen to XRP 1 second after the snapshot?
There is always this risk of a price drop. I mean, right now we're in quite volatile waters, let's say. With Bitcoin correcting, it usually takes the entire market down. I still believe that as a run-up to the 12th of December, I think we will see a run-up in terms of price of XRP. Not sure whether we'll breach the $1 or $1 mark, but afterwards I would expect it to drop. That usually happens. It's also very natural because people are just buying to get the dividends, if you want, or to get the airdrop and then selling right away. It's absolutely normal and nothing to be worried about.
Yeah, and I would agree with you. Just for some sort of background information for everyone, through the month of November, our XRP volumes were significantly greater than what they are normally, so much so that they were marginally greater than Ethereum. Now, normally it'd be Bitcoin, then Ethereum, then kind of everything else significantly less. But we saw a lot more XRP, as did I'm sure every other platform out there. So there's certainly a lot of what I would say is speculative interest in this coin. So off the back of that, I would I personally think that we'll probably see quite a sharp sell off within a second or so after that snapshot. But that's not investment advice, that's just my own personal opinion.
Of course, of course. Yeah, I see it similarly, to be honest. And I think, to be honest, I still think XRP also has an interesting case, whether you believe in this airdrop or not. So it will be interesting to see kind of how the portfolios of different people or institutions will rebalance after this. There are a couple of more questions from Cosmin, but can I transfer my XRP tokens to Swissquote without sell and buy? I know you hold an external wallet, so only purchase is possible. Will this be changed?
That's essentially a compliance challenge for us. We really do take compliance and regulations extremely seriously. And so there are, at the moment, we accept Bitcoins into our ecosystem from 5 exchanges that we are comfortable with. There's unfortunately a lot of exchanges and other services that we are not comfortable with, given that we're a regulated Swiss bank, hence we will not accept. So, and we don't accept XRP. So in this case, you would have to, if you wanted them to be within Swissquote, you would have to unfortunately sell on the external, the other platform, and then buy them with your crypto assets or your fiat assets on the Swissquote platform. I appreciate you would then have a spread both ways, but that's the setup currently.
Chris is asking, was Codeus not supposed to bring smart contracts to XRP ledger? Chris, I mean, it doesn't exclude it completely. I think there are two completely different projects. So essentially, XRP ledger or the Ripple Labs team, depending on their strategy, they can of course invest into 5 coins or 5 projects that bring technically smart contracts to this platform, but it doesn't necessarily mean that it is just one solution that will work for all. I think with time and with the market changing, and again with DeFi getting into the spotlight this year, I think that will be definitely a focus, or that's why it's also being pushed, I think. Then Michael is asking, does Swissquote have plans to lower their fees for trading crypto in 2021?
Yeah, Michael, good question. And I appreciate that we do get asked this regularly. The challenge is that, yes, there are absolutely some platforms that are cheaper than ours. But if you want to take the risk, and you can sum up what the risk might be on these very well-known platforms, but some of them do not have a proper address. some of them may well disappear at some point tomorrow in 6 months' time, who knows? But at the end of the day, we're a regulated Swiss bank. We have all those processes in place, the security processes, huge security teams to make sure our platform's secure. We have all those compliance people. So we've got a higher cost base than a lot of others or some of these crypto trading platforms. So we have to, on that basis, demand a higher fee than some of them. I think there are certainly plenty of platforms that are more expensive than us. So given that we are a regulated Swiss bank and you've got the trust factor, then I think our fee structure is quite reasonable.
I agree. And maybe to chime in here, as someone who is pretty active in this space, I can also guarantee you that it's not just the small exchanges that are, getting away with, like the ones you mentioned with no addresses. It's also the very, very big exchanges that from today to tomorrow, due to regulatory action or to any kind of embezzlement charges and so on, they can get away with your money. So you have to be quite careful. And I think their Swissquote is definitely on the safe side. And I think that is what makes the fees or worth it to trade crypto on Swissquote compared to all these exchanges that are dubious, that are shady, that have weird addresses from countries that you cannot spell and so on. Excellent. I think that covers also the questions. If there are no more questions, then of course you can send me an email or you can send an email to the guys from Swissquote. They will probably forward it. But can we get the presentation via email? Cosmin, I can do that. If you are the only person, you can just send me an email and I will gladly send you the presentation. Otherwise, I'm also happy to give that to the colleagues at Swissquote in order to share this presentation with you guys. I would also like to have this presentation from Marx. Excellent. Let's see whether we can actually organize this. Hopefully we can share it, but no problem. I can share that presentation with you guys. Can we see? I think the recording, Marcel, will be on YouTube. I would say tomorrow, but you correct me if I'm wrong, Chris.
Yeah, that's up to Stefano. He's the boss for this. He's confirming. Yes.
Ah, excellent.
Stefano will be up till midnight tonight doing his magic to create this webinar for us all.
Excellent, excellent.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much for attending, everyone. And obviously, a huge thank you to Feyyaz. We, as usual, appreciate his support and his inputs. And I hope you all have pleasure trading XRP in the next few days. If you have further questions about that or any other cryptocurrencies, please feel free to contact myself or Feyyaz, or in fact Stefano Gianti directly, and we can help answer those. Well, have a fantastic evening, everyone, and well, take care, and we'll speak to you all soon. Thank you.
Thank you, guys. Bye-bye.